accused to support freedom of determination, that is in separatism, is as foolish and hypocritical as accusing those who advocate freedom of divorce of encouraging the destruction of family ties. V.I. Lenin.
July. Top. The Charter of the United Nations indicates in the numerous provisions the wide possibilities of the international recognition of human rights. In the preamble of the Charter, the United Nations have expressed, among other things, the determination to reaffirm faith in fundamental human rights, in the dignity and worth of the human person, in the equal rights of men and women. Stop.
Dateline, Saigon, 20th July. Stop. Jet fighters, helicopters and gunships raked the jungle with rockets while B-52s rained down 1.2 million pounds of bombs indiscriminately. Stop. The climax came last week when the US called into play yet another aerial weapon, a gigantic 15,000-pound bomb called the Daisy Cutter, because its explosion creates instant clearings down below. Stop.
Dateline, Bongao, July 20. Stop. It wasn't difficult to find them. They were coming like an endless procession of sleepwalkers. As if instinctively, they moved on. Stop. They carried on their heads their last worldly possessions. Stop. Some faces reflected the horror enacted before their eyes only a few days ago. Stop. On other faces prevailed a layer of stunned indifference. Stop. As if after such a seemingly endless journey, it didn't really matter whether they were dead or alive. Stop. Their unspeakable suffering made us wonder, for what crimes must they go through this terrifying ordeal? They didn't know. Neither did we. But we all wanted to know how long must the world allow Yahya and his accomplices to go on committing genocidal crimes against such innocent people. Stop. Clearly, they have been walking for days, without food, without sleep. The fatigue was killing. But they had to move on. They had to find safety before rest. Stop. And rest did come at long last. Some found it under a tree, some in disused warehouses. Stop. There are many refugee camps in India, but there could never be enough when the refugees arrive in hundreds and thousands by the hour. Naturally, new arrivals could not be accommodated in them. Stop. In the nearby refugee camp, we came across an old woman wading through the slush. She was looking for shelter before the rains came down again. But every inch was already occupied. She was finding it hard to believe that after 90 long years, she would be without a roof over her head with monsoon approaching. An unknown fear gripped her. Was she going to die after all, after surviving the fatigue of the long, long journey from her home village? Stop. In another camp, we found a girl a little over 16. Her father was a shopkeeper in Khulna. The army entered their home during curfew hours. They looted all the cash and gold ornaments. Then she was flung onto the floor and six of the army brutes raped her by turn right in front of her family. Before they left, they lined up her parents, two brothers and uncle.
Yahya Khan has surpassed Nadir Shah in killing the people of Bangladesh. Yahya Khan has surpassed Taimur Lang in raping the women of Bangladesh. Yahya Khan has surpassed Sultan Mahmud of Ghazni in looting and burning the houses of the people of Bangladesh. Yahya Khan has surpassed Mussolini in causing havoc on the land of Bangladesh. Yahya Khan has surpassed Hitler. Yahya.
In another camp, we met an old man of 78 to give us an account of the Pakistani brutality in his village in Rashahi. Over 20 people were killed by strafing by the Pakistani Air Force before the army arrived. They had camped in the nearby town and apparently asked the people to get on with their jobs. Then suddenly they invaded the villages, lined up all able-bodied men and shot them. Then followed the familiar orgy. They looted their money and valuables and raped their women, as if that was not enough. Before leaving, they set fire to their houses. Why, the old man kept asking, stop.
The Charter lays down as one of the purposes of the United Nations the achievement of international cooperation in promoting and encouraging respect for human rights and for fundamental freedom for all, without distinction as to race, sex, language or religion. Stop.
Dateline, Washington, 22nd July. Stop. The Kelly case. President Nixon defended his intervention on behalf of William Kelly after the lieutenant's murder conviction in the My Lai massacre in Vietnam. Stop. Lieutenant Kelly was convicted earlier for massacring innocent and unarmed men, women and children of a whole village. Stop.
100 My Lais took place in Bangladesh. Binod Bihari is a witness to one. The sadistic killers arrived in his Faridpur village and without warning... massacred 253 men, women and children. There are many witnesses to similar massacres that took place in Dhaka on and after March 25. Hundreds of workers were machine gunned to death along with their families as the army set fire to their shacks. Several hundred laborers were massacred in their sleep on the waterfront terminal. At Jinjira, on the other side of the river Buriganga, the army killed more than 6,000 people in one afternoon. Which court would condemn these cold-blooded murderers? Stop. At Goa, the Bengal, we had the misfortune of witnessing a cruel twist of history. Some glorious pages in the history of our people began here centuries ago. From palaces like this one, our ancestors had ruled the rich land of Bengal. Today, their descendants have returned in tattered rags, penniless, homeless, and hungry, threatened with extermination by some barbarous hordes right from the pages of medieval history. At Gaur, history seemed to have gone round a full circle. It appeared as if time stood still all these centuries. These frightened lumps of humanity huddled in these ancient ruins were indeed a legacy of history. Nothing could wipe out such a blot from world's conscience. Yet this unbelievable tragedy is taking place at a time when we had almost convinced ourselves of the greatness of modern civilization. Man has set his foot on the moon, and we were all ready to believe that human civilization was on the threshold of a new era where man's exploitation by man could be found only in history books. We were rudely roused from our dreams by the sadistic fascists from West Pakistan. Unbelievable though it may seem, it all happened under the very nose of the self-appointed defenders of human rights. Stop. Monsoon was back and it began to rain incessantly. But compared to Pakistani brutality, weather's fury meant little to the refugees. They kept moving on and on. The endless human stream roused so many questions in my mind. What really was their fault? How deep was their participation in politics to deserve such terrible victimization? Did any nation or race ever had to pay such a price for exercising their right to vote for someone they liked? As we watched the refugees, suddenly we noticed a curious movement. We moved nearer and she turned out to be an old woman aged anything between 80 and 100. She could see very little, but she had acquired a sense of direction and distance with the use of a bamboo stick. She appeared to understand my questions, but would only reply, "All gone, nothing left." It was amazing that with so little power in her eyes, she dared to take on the hazardous journey. Crawling like that, she had covered nearly 100 miles. Will she survive the fatigue? I asked myself. What really have these Pakistani mariners done to make such an old woman want to flee? Stop.
The observance of fundamental human rights has, insofar as it is the subject matter of legal obligations, ceased to be one of exclusive domestic jurisdiction of states and has become a matter of legitimate concern for the United Nations and its members.
At a Liberation Army training camp. We entered the liberated area of Bangladesh a few days ago. It was a glorious day. The sun was peeping through the banana trees and clusters of bamboo. Birds were singing merrily. The charm of this typically Bengali setting made me forget for a while the grim, bloody battle that was raging all around. Suddenly, we had our first view of the freedom fighters. A band of armed guerrillas were perhaps returning from an operation. In a way, the sight fitted perfectly with the idyllic surroundings. They soon vanished in the woods and we proceeded toward our destination. After a few miles' walk, we crossed a river. About an hour later, as we turned round a huge banyan tree, we were challenged by a group of guerrillas. On being satisfied with our identity, they welcomed us and offered to lead us to the Liberation Army camp about 30 miles inside. They were all wearing lungi and vests, the dress of ordinary villagers. All carried rifles. After about 3 hours' walk, a cluster of white tents suddenly rose before our eyes in an open space. With great care, we approached, lest we got fired upon by the guards hiding in the jungle. The camp commandant was an officer of the Defiant Bengal Regiment and also a daredevil guerrilla fighter himself.
Well, we didn't want this war. This war was forced upon us. All we wanted to establish the right of the people. But Yahya Khan and his forces, they started treating our people like cats and dogs.
Say that we're ill-equipped. We are not. We've got the moral strength. We have to fight. We will fight. And the victory is certainly assured. Our men are not trained, but with the desire to fight, they were learning very fast.
The camp was bustling with activity. We were convinced that the Pakistani mercenaries were a pitiful match for these young lions dedicated to liberate their motherland, whatever the cost. After an all-night walk through the jungle, we returned to the Indian frontier. On a dull afternoon, we visited a refugee camp once again. This time, there was a curious new arrival. She was barely 11 and was weeping in silence. Nobody knew how she came or where she came from. What was her name? Nobody knew. She would not talk. Was she a Hindu, a Muslim, Christian, Buddhist? I approached her, drew her nearer and tried to make her talk. I tried again and again. She seemed to respond at last. Her lips trembled. Perhaps she was going to talk. I kept asking, "What is your name?" Her lips parted a little. I asked her again, "What is your name? Where are you from? Where are you from? What is your name?" No, she could not talk. It didn't really matter. She is one of a million, 10 million, 75 million men, women and children, every one of whom has a tale of horror to tell. Each face would represent a profile of human suffering engraved on the face of time. History has seen it all, again and again. In Paris and Spain, in Auschwitz and Buchenwald, in Algeria and Palestine, in South Africa, Congo and Haiti, in Vietnam. Neither is there heroic resistance an isolated happening. It is indeed an integral part of a relentless struggle being waged by working men and women for their democratic right to choose their own destiny. In the interest of this international solidarity, freedom-loving peoples of the world must fight alongside the people of Bangladesh and do everything in their power to bring to an end this grisly campaign of
genocide. Stop genocide.
Genocide.
Stop.
Stop. Stop. Stop. Stop. Stop.